Okay, let's take a look at some practice problems that will help you with the third assignment for Chapter 5. The first one is Exercise 5-8B. This involves intermittent transactions, so buying and selling and buying and selling, which is a little bit more like the real world than the problems we've had up until now, where we buy, and then we make one sale. So in this case, the company started out with 180 units at $10 per unit. It's important to capture that information because it's not shown in this same format here. So we start out with 180 units at $10. We buy 200 units at $12. That's how much we paid for them. We sell 150 units at $20. So that's the price we charge the customer. We purchase 300 units at 15, and then we sell 450 units at 25. And I'll come back to this math I have here in a minute. So they want us to put these transactions, all of which are cash transactions, into our grid here. So the first thing we have is we purchase that inventory. So we purchase 200 units at $12. So 2,400 in cash leaves our business, and we now have 2,400 in inventory as a result of that transaction. Next transaction, on April 1st, we sell 150 units at $20. So remember, whenever we sell physical products, we always have two transactions that we record, the sale and the cost of the sale. So when we record the sale, I'm going to receive $3,000 in cash. That's 150 times the $20 selling price. That pulls retained earnings up, and I recognize revenue. Then I need to recognize the cost side of it. So in this case here, I'm selling 150 units, and it's FIFO, so I'm giving customers the oldest units first. Well, the oldest units are these $10 units that I have in beginning inventory. So my cost of the sale is going to be the 150 units I sold times the $10 cost for my beginning inventory. So I reduce my inventory by 1,500, I pulled retained earnings down by 1,500, and I recognize 1,500 in expense. Next transaction, I purchase 300 units at $15. So 4,500 in cash leaves my business, and I have $4,500 in inventory now, additional inventory. Now here's the tricky one. On December 1st, I sold 450 units at $25. So I have to say, how do I build that up? Well, from the beginning inventory, remember I sold 150 of these 180 units, so I have 30 left. So those 30 will be the first part I give the customer. So 30 at $10. Then I'm going to give them all of my January 1st purchase, 200 at $12. And that's not enough. I've given them 230, but they bought 450. So I'm going to have to dip into that August 1st purchase and give them 220 at $15. When I do all that math, I get a cost of $6,000. So I recognize the cost of, I recognize first the sale. I receive cash of 450 times 25. So I recognize a sale of 11,250 and pull up retained earnings and recognize revenue. And then the cost side of that, I went through this FIFO exercise to come up with 6,000. So I reduce inventory by 6,000. And I pull retained earnings down by 6,000 and recognize an expense. Now notice here, we can also take a look at how much do we have left in inventory. So in this case, I had 450 in that last purchase, and I just gave 220 to the customer. So let's double check ourselves here. So I had 450 and I gave 220 to the customer, so I should have 230 left in inventory that are costed at $15, so that's $34.50. And I don't total this here, but if I had the beginning inventory, it would total $34.50. So hopefully that was helpful to you. The next one I want to look at is Exercise 5-11B, and this deals with lower of cost or market. So in this case, I have three items, and again, I would do this regardless of what inventory flow method I chose. So I've got three items, the quantity, the unit cost, and the market value. So in this case here, I'll fill out this grid, some of which is probably already populated on the website there. So the first thing I'm going to look at is the lower of cost or market. So between 20 and 18, which is lower? 18 is lower. So I'll go with 18 there. Of 25 and 24, 24 is lower, so I'll go with that. And with $10 cost and $12 market value, $10 cost is lower. So this column F here is asking for total cost. So that's 400 times 20 for 8,000, 500 times 25 for 12,500, 300 times 10 for 3,000. So I have a total cost of inventory of 23,500. Then I'm going to multiply this lower of cost or market column by my quantity. I get the figures you see here, and that totals $22,200. So because two of these items here, my selling price is less than what I paid for it, I need to take that hit and recognize that expense now. So in that case, my adjustment is $1,300. The last one I want to review is exercise 5-14B. And this deals with estimating ending inventory, so using the gross margin method. So this is a good way of determining maybe if there's been fraud or theft or something like that to determine what I should have in inventory relative to what I do have. So they give us some information here. Beginning inventory and purchases for the year is $250 plus $500,000. So I have $750,000 in goods available for sale. That's at cost. That's what I pay for it. My sales for the year were $850,000. That's the price I charge the customer. So I want to be really careful not to mix prices and costs together. I want to keep them separately. When I counted my inventory at the end of the year, I had $40,000. Again, that's at cost. So historically, we have a 20% gross margin on our sales. So Frank thinks there might be a problem, so we're going to evaluate this situation. So they ask us for a couple of different things to walk us through this. So first of all, what is the dollars of gross margin? So $850,000 in sales times 20%, we would have earned a gross margin of $170,000 on that. Next, they ask, what is cost of goods sold? Well, cost of goods sold, remember sales minus cost of goods sold equals gross margin. So I could get cost of goods sold by itself by having sales minus gross margin. So sales minus the gross margin meant my cost must have been $680. That must have been my cost of goods sold. So the ending inventory, I'm going to take my beginning inventory of $250 plus the purchases of $500. My goods available for sale are $750,000. So if $680 left with customers, I should have had $70,000 on my shelf at the end of the year. That's what should have been left over. So in that case, my inventory shortage is $70,000 minus the $40,000. I'm missing $30,000 worth of inventory. Okay, so an explanation of that. So the ending inventory count could be wrong. So why is there a shortage? The 20% margin could be wrong. Maybe my margin has slipped. Or there could have been theft or fraud of some kind. I don't know that for sure based on this information, but I know what I could check. I could double count the inventory and I could verify my margin. So that would give me the evidence I need to say what exactly I was missing. So if you have any questions, please shoot me an email and I'll talk to you again when I lecture on Chapter 6. Thank you.